Good morning to you.
Good morning.
How are you?
Nice, good.
How things?
So is it like have you started having these conversations or
Yes.
okay?
Absolutely. Yeah. Finished with a couple of guests, and you're on the line, and today I'm chatting with you. How are things otherwise after we spoke last time?
Things are, I mean, yeah, so work-wise they've extended till end of this year, so we don't have I mean, there's no work from office till end of this year. Yeah, maybe like stretch till March 2021 is what we are assuming. Yeah,
Oh, is that so?
got used to the new normal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Very well. Thank you so much for accepting and coming on this event. We're very happy to have you because we're definitely looking at leaders like you in the space of learning and development, and share with us the effect of books in your own journey, and that could help a lot of budding leaders who are listening to this conversation or would listen to you in the next 45 minutes. We have had a couple of illustrious leaders like you already on the panel, and I'm happy to have you today, Srijit, once again. Before we get started, let me quickly introduce you to the audience. So, good morning, everyone. Welcome to this series once again. We have the next guest, Srijit Krishnan, who is the head of L&D for Sony India Software Center. Not many of us may know him in terms of his designation that he is occupying. You'll have to go to LinkedIn and take a look at that. But most of us know him by the viral wisdom shots that has made him fairly famous across multiple places. And I'm told by him that it has also crossed the boundaries of India and gone across other continents. And it's a lovely piece of work that he started off. And Srijit, with your permission, if I can share that he started off as part of an effort that he wanted to put as a coachee, and he promised this to his coach. And it's so nice to see a coachee living up to the promise and starting off something, attempting something, Srijit. And today it's viral. You have it across WhatsApp, you have it across the LinkedIn, and people love it. For a couple of things, Srijit, which I would want to definitely give it as a compliment before we start, is I personally love the articulation. I personally love
Thanks.
the calmness in your voice, because there is a learning that is coming out of a story, and that has to come with a lot of serenity in the voice and smoothness and calmness, and it can't be rushed through. And I think you do it beautifully well, and the way you end it kind of leaves a mark in the listener's mind who thinks and reflects for a couple of seconds after the end of your talk. But this made tremendous sense to me. And that's what it did to me also. And I did share that with you when we first spoke. So continue doing that, continue spreading learning, Srijit. Thank you so much for doing
Thank you
that.
so much. Thanks for that lovely introduction. Yeah, I'm happy to contribute to your initiative. I mean, when you spoke to me about this initiative of yours, it was unique, first of all, and something to do with books again. Yeah, so I'm doing a great job. Yeah, happy to contribute in whatever way I can. Yeah,
Thank you,
let's
sir.
start.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So let's get started. The first question, book and Srijit, how do you see these two words connected?
Okay, so it starts back. I mean, I think I started reading at the age of, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7, and I was fascinated by children's books, other than more than the academic book. So I used to look forward to that. We get like weekly, some kind of children's magazine and things like that. So I used to look forward to read those books, right? It starts there, started there, and I remember, like, during my school days, I used to save my pocket money to buy books. So we had this one HNC bookstore next to my school. Those days, some 20, 30 bucks, but then I was like, used to like, really crazy about books. I had a small library way back in school.
Wow.
And I'm from Trivandrum, so we had this public library there. So the cutoff to get membership was 14 years. So I was waiting to turn 14 to get membership there. And that was, and every Saturday I used to visit. So for books and me, personally, I don't know, what's the real reason, but I'm inclined towards books. I love reading more than fiction, non-fiction books. And I strongly believe that it shaped me as a person, with respect to my career, with respect to my personality. It played a very big role. So books are,
Lovely.
even now I have a big library outside.
Yeah, lovely. So if we go back, how do you see it? Is it somewhere genetically given to you, or is it something that you picked up as a complete habit in your family?
Genetic, a couple of, not my dad or mom, maybe my mom used to read, but there are a couple of my, uncles and relatives, they had small book collection, but otherwise I don't think anybody in my family who is really crazy about books like the way I am. Yeah.
So you are seen as the first formal voracious reader of the family.
And these are like pre-internet days, right? I mean, in the sense like we didn't have internet at home. So our only way of spending time, either you spend time with your friends or, reading books. I mean, there's no other mode of, way of spending time. So books were my constant companion those days.
Fantastic. So lovely. Picking up books at such an early age, and I love that waiting for 14 to get a membership.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting stuff.
That was like an amazing collection of books. I mean, I still, it was a British library, pretty old one. Good leaf story building. It's filled with books. I mean, used to look forward to that, those Saturday, visit to that place.
Fantastic. So tell me, Srijit, reading you've picked up very, very early in life, and you've been reading for many, many years now. And how has this habit as a reader contributed in your journey as a leader?
Okay, so this is my personal belief. Okay, not personal belief, which I even observed with people. So to be successful, whatever is your definition of success with respect to career, finance, relationship, or whatever it is, right? 80% is mindset, right? Only 20% is skill set and your process and things like that, right? So if you can shift that, if you can change your mindset, the game will change. So for me, books basically played a very important role in shifting my mindset, the way I looked at things. And of course, you can learn a lot of strategies, techniques, tools, and things like that. So basically, you are doing smart work than hard work. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can actually replicate the same formula or same strategies by reading biographies or the best practices. So I personally believe you can actually cut down decades into days if you are a reader.
Right. I think it makes sense. Very powerful point, because I'm also somebody who reads books. I always keep telling people in my interventions who come as participants, leaders, that look, the books that we're talking about actually are so beautifully written by the authors. They have actually given you templates and tools that you can straight away pick it up and apply at workplace. Instead of seeing this just as a chandamama or a tinkle, if you see it as an applicable tool-based book, I think every author has attempted to give something that we can pick up and go back and try it work, whether it is behavioral or whether it is process, tools, or whatever you want to call it. I think that's the beauty of these authors. And you're very right in saying this, Srijit, that the research has been done by somebody already. Why go back and break our head doing that? Pick it up and just delete and use it.
Absolutely.
It makes life easier as well. And then also gives us time to read more books.
Correct. Yeah. So it's like the difference between smart work and hard work, right? Absolutely. Hard work is like, you are digging at the same place, expecting water. But smart work is knowing where there is water. And you save time and effort and you get the same result.
Absolutely. Very well. So getting on to the next thought process that I had, so many books. What made you pick this powerful book of Simon Sinek? Start with why.
When it comes to business books, right, or leadership books, there are a couple of books which those books actually stand out. So this book is in that category. There are a couple of books, but this is one of my favorite book because it is in sync with what I believe and about the whole thing. So to give a background of this book, I think I got a forward from somebody, 2011 or 12, at TED Talk, right? By Simon Sinek. Okay, so it was his viral TED Talk. And that was the first time I'm listening to him. I didn't know about him. So then I searched about him and then I came to know there's a book. So I have this habit of, especially in the last couple of years, I listen to the audiobook first. I mean, I used to buy a lot of books in the past, but these days my style is first I listen to the audiobook, and if I like the book, then I buy the book. Because in a physical book, it has an energy, right? So you get some kind of feeling when you hold the physical book. So this book was like that. So I listened to the audiobook version first and then decided to buy the book. So I felt a lot of things which he shared in this book are things which connected with me. And I really believe that when it comes to business, when it comes to leadership, when it comes to communication, you get like a lot of insights, right, in this book.
Yeah. I think similar experience for me also, because the concept of the golden circle that he talks about, I think very, very fundamentally it goes back even the elements of spiritualism or mythology, wherever you want to go back, it kind of sits beautifully into anything. Like it's mostly the series that can be put into any space of life or any space of work, right? I think it's a very simple model, yet a very powerful model that we can apply anywhere. Yeah, so I think that's my favorite as well. Simon talks about multiple things in this book. You know, he talks about a very powerful thing called, there are a lot of leaders. You know, you are a leader. I have been in my past. Many people around us. It's a very simple statement that he says, but when you listen to it, it makes tremendous sense. You know, he says, there are leaders and there are those who lead. It made tremendous sense in my head. I would like to hear from you, Srijit. How do you interpret this statement? And how have you used this in your journey?
Yeah, so it's a very powerful statement. So when it comes to power, right? So there are different kinds of power. You have your positional power, your personal power, you know, your physical power. And my favorite and the simplest definition of leadership, you know, leadership is influence, right? And basically, you influence people to take action or and to contribute to your vision, whatever. So, but leadership, the simplest definition is leadership is influence. Now, how do we influence somebody? Right. So like hundreds of years back, people used to influence with physical power, right? Kings and, you know, even British. So they had physical power and they influenced people. And then comes information, knowledge is power. But even knowledge, if you look at it now, knowledge is not power. It's just potential power. And I say not power because it sits there everywhere, right? It's there in your fingertips. But 100 years back, that was not the case, right? Correct. People who knew something, they were regarded as really powerful people.
Yeah.
Right. So now, so knowledge is not power. So now the real power, right, in 21st century is your personal power. So your personal power to influence somebody. So this statement, what he says, right, it's actually the difference between positional power and personal power. So there are leaders, you know, who have positional power, right? They have the power, they have the designation and things like that. And then there are leaders who have something called personal power, right, driven by purpose. And he follows them. You know, people have been inspired by those leaders. So that's why it's a very powerful statement. And, you know, I really like believe in that statement because, you know, we use this word very casually, the word leadership, leader, and things like that. But, you know, in the real sense, you know, there are only very few leaders, right, who can actually inspire people. And to inspire somebody, you have to inspire yourself first. Right? Otherwise, you can influence in different way. You know, he talks about inspiration and manipulation. Right? Yeah. So most people use other way of getting things through manipulation.
Correct. But
real leaders inspire people. Right.
Absolutely.
So, so it's a very powerful statement.
So what's your take and advice for the budding leaders who are listening to you, Srijit? That, you know, earlier they used to say leaders were born. Today they say leaders are made. And the management says that the reason why we remove the word born and said made is because you can acquire a leadership qualities and capabilities through reading, through practice, through multiple sources. It doesn't have to be genetically given to you. You may come from an absolutely, space where you don't have leadership background, but you may emerge as somebody based on what you've picked up in life. Yeah. What is your input to the budding leaders?
The first thing is, before influencing others, you have to influence yourself, right? So you have to start with yourself and you have to work on yourself. So a lot of people do the other way around. You know, they think, let me try to change him or change my team. It doesn't work like that, right? So you have to walk the talk. So when I say walk the talk, so you have to work on yourself. You have to invest in yourself. So I like this, you read this book called The Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin. So he talks about, so basically it's a small book. So he wanted to develop a lot of attributes, leadership attributes, attributes of successful people. So what he used to do is he used to pick up one or two attributes,
okay,
like discipline or determination. So he'll pick up, one area and he needs to work really hard on that. Till it becomes part of himself, right? So apparently, in that book, he says he developed multiple, you know, like leadership attributes by working on himself. Mm-hmm. So same principle. Now, you know, identify, right, what are your areas of improvement, you know, observe people, you know, read from books, you know, what are those leadership attributes, and then see the gap, right, where am I and where I want to go, and then work on yourself. And when you work on yourself and have a, like, a, you know, bigger goal, you know, that makes you a visionary, and then you have a clear vision, and then when you have a clear goal, when you have a clear track, people will follow you.
Right.
If you are lost, you will not have anybody looking at you. But when you are clear about what you want, you will have people, you know, following you. So that's how it works.
Right. So you're more telling people to have a very inward and outward approach. First, look at yourself. Right. Focus on what you are as a leader, and that would be visible. That would be clearly seen by the environment, isn't it? Eventually, because it will come out as behaviors.
Yeah. So in this book, they talk about energy and charisma.
Yeah.
Right. Somewhere.
So, he says energy motivates, but charisma inspires.
Ah, correct. So now, I worked in you know, Infosys for 6 years, right? So I had this opportunity to sit through or listen to Narayana Murthy a couple of times. Mm. You know, something about him, right? Mm. He's not an energetic leader. I mean, when I say energetic in the definition of, like, you know, that outward energy, right? He is very composed and things like that. So if you have like 2-3 speakers, there are a lot of speakers who are very energetic, you know, you have that motivational speaker kind of energy, and then they know all the stuff, right? So those are engaging talks, you know, we listen to those people. But when he talks, right, you know, something hits your heart.
Correct.
Because, you know, it's just coming out of your heart, you know, from his own experience. Mm. You know, each word he says, he believes in what he says. So that makes all the difference. See, I'm a facilitator myself, right? I used to do a lot of training and things like that. So I can, like, you know, read a couple of things, and, you know, I can just, you know, using my communication skills, I can just, you know, give that to people. But I know for a fact that will not have any impact on anybody. I mean, it'll be an engaging session. People will love what I say, right? They'll clap for me, but I know that they will not take action. But there are people, right, who walk the talk. When they say something, right, the influence is very powerful. Now, those are charismatic leaders because, you know, they believe, you know, like, you know, in each atom of their body believes in what they say. So, and that's the difference. I mean, you know, that's what you have to aspire to be. Yeah.
Right. So, are you also trying to say that the young leaders, as they are rising in their leadership journey, would need to wait to become a 50 plus, 60 plus, or that age of Narayana Murthy to really inspire, or will they be able to inspire at an early age as well?
No, what's your take on that? If you read, so I have a video of his, just because we're talking about Narayana Murthy, so I have a, you know, video of him, like his biography kind of a thing. Hmm. We made it during his farewell. So if you observe, you know, his background, right? Hmm. He was a great leader even at his, you know, late 20s or 30s, right? So he really, like, there was a time when they were about to shut down the company, right? So all the other founders were ready to sell the, you know, the stakes, but he was like, you know, no, I'll buy it from you in case if you really want to sell that. So he actually, you know, demonstrated those attributes even at a very young age, right? So so you don't have to wait for 50 to, you know, to become a leader. So you can actually, like, you know, work on yourself at a very early age. So it's basically, it's your experiences. So I strongly believe leadership, yeah, you can read books, you can attend workshops, but at the end of the day, your experiences really matter.
Absolutely.
The you know, whom you spend time with, right? Your role models, right? The organization setup, right? All those things will really contribute than, you know, reading books on the subject. Yeah, books actually will help you to practice what you've read, right? So that's the only difference.
Absolutely. You're very right in saying this, Rijit, because beyond the books, the entire environment in which we operate plays a very significant role in giving us lessons and learnings and make us a far better leader. Books is one of the tools that definitely accentuates, you know, that journey of yours. Very beautifully said. Absolutely. So Simon also talks about this in his book, and I a little bit of background. I worked with TVS Motors as an organization earlier.
Okay.
They very strongly follow total quality management, right? And they believe that anything is measurable under the sky. And I today believe that very strongly. Simon talks about this very powerful statement as fit by design and fit by default. So when I saw this, it talks about an experience of an automobile industry also. I thought, can leaders be by default or should leaders be by design? In the current millennial world, how do you see it?
So, talking about that car example, right? Japanese and American, car manufacturing unit, right? Where Japanese design, they start with an end
in mind,
right? Yeah. Yeah. True. So I think, if you look at current leaders, right? If you don't have that end in mind, right? And if you don't start with that why, start with purpose, you will face challenges anyway on the way, right? But if you have thought through this, and if you have a clear vision, if you have a clear journey path, right, you'll be able to, overcome those challenges faster than taking as it comes. So you have these two approaches, right? Taking life as it comes and then having a clear goal in mind and then before see. So Japanese are, actually like that, right? If you work, if you look at any Japanese companies, so they have this, eye for detail, they plan to the core, right? They're very process oriented, which is good, actually, which works. So the same with leadership. So if you are a visionary, if you are a leader with a strong end in mind, things will fall in place, right?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you have to, face the challenges, on the way, and then you have to, do those, quick fixes.
Corrections later.
It will not sustain. That's the problem, right? It may work today, it may not work tomorrow.
Absolutely.
And then again, you are on different pages. Not everybody's on the same page.
Correct. Yeah. You used a very powerful word, Srijit, called sustain, right? And I think leadership is all about sustainability. Yeah. It's about long-term impact that you have on the individuals. And we know that when we create that impact, people follow you, across organizations as well. We have seen experiences, right? Yeah. If that is what is inspiration, if that is what is leadership all about, how do you relate this powerful concept of golden circle that hit me very hard? I'm sure it would have hit you also very hard. To be very honest, Srijit, I had 2 full days of deep reflection on how did this guy come up with this 3 simple circles. It was always a why, what, and a how kind of a thought process in my head. He moved it and made why, how, and a what.
Yeah.
How do you see this concept of golden circle playing in your life, Srijit?
So I'm always fascinated by human behavior. So I, other than this self-help books and spiritual books, I read a lot of psychology books, right? So I have a background in psychology. So in psychology, when it comes to motivation, so what motivates somebody to take action?
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of theories on that, but one of the strongest motivation factor, right, in human behavior is a strong why.
Okay.
So I'll give an example, right? So imagine you decided to, go for jogging every day morning, right? You put your alarm at 6 a.m. and things like that. Mm. So on a Sunday morning, 6 a.m., alarm rings, right?
Mm.
If you are if you're a weak-minded person, most people.
I want to snooze it.
On a Sunday morning, you will not take action, right? But imagine that 6:30 a.m. or 7 a.m., the watchman in your apartment is shouting, there's a fire in this apartment. Right. So what will be your behavior? You will jump out of the window, right? Because there's a fire. So now, if you look at, both the cases, right? In the first case, you wanted to. It's not that you don't want to jog. Want to jog. You want to run. You want to take care of your health.
Mm.
It's a strong need. You know that the importance of that, right?
Right.
But there was no drive. That why was not strong enough to push you to take action. So if you look at human behavior, right, any behavior, whenever there is a strong why, people always take action. Right. It's always like that.
Right.
So if you ask me what drives people, it's basically the reason, right? The why, if they have a strong why. So if you look at this golden circle, so he's connecting a very powerful, psychology element, which is there in a lot of books, but he put it in a very different way, which is this, the purpose. And because we are wired like that, right?
Okay.
So we have these two brains, rational brain and human emotional brain.
Mm.
So most of the decisions, most of our feelings, all those things are influenced by our emotional brain.
Okay.
Right? Emotional brain, it moves us to take action Only when there is a strong why, okay, when there is a purpose. You know, if you don't have that, you know, if you look at our own life, right? Whenever it's like a must to do thing, we always did that. Right. Whenever it's a good to do or nice to do, you know, we always
park. We're okay to procrastinate it.
Correct, yeah. Right. So this is a human behavior. Now, when it comes to leadership, so at the end of the day, a leader wants to influence somebody. So when I say influence, what? He wants to influence someone's behavior towards a positive result or a positive action or whatever you want, right? Mm. Or when it comes to customer market, the Apple story, right. Or what he says. Right. So basically, like as an organization, they want to get profit by selling their products, right? Right. So now, how do we make people buy their products? Right? So we tend to think that people buy products out of logic or out of data. Mm. But he proved in that book, and which is true, you know, we are emotional beings. You know, we don't buy things out of logic. We tend to think that we buy things out of data, logic, and things like that. Right. But the truth is, if you look at your last purchase, you know, whatever you got from Amazon, at the end of the day, you click that button out of emotion, right?
Absolutely.
So there is some emotional trigger. Now, why do people buy BMW or Mercedes-Benz? It's not logic. You know, if it's logic, if you want to move from point A to point B, you can buy any car,
correct.
Right?
Correct.
But you know, people buy Mercedes because that's an identity. That's a emotion.
Right.
So when you have a strong emotion, so yeah, we are emotional beings. You know, all our decisions, all our actions, it's driven by emotions. And purpose play a very important role. Other than purpose, the other factor is happiness and all. So that's a different thing. But purpose play a very important role in driving human behavior. Okay. Right? So if you look at the golden circle, you know, what he says is absolutely true. Because if you really want to influence people, whether to influence somebody to buy a product or influence somebody to take an action, so you have to communicate that why part. Now, people may not know, but when you communicate that why part, because at the end of the day, you know, we all, you know, have our own purpose, values, and things like that.
Right.
When an organization or when a leader communicate your own personal purpose, you may not even know which is there, right? Your own values, right? In a particular way. And when you connect to that, that's when, you know, you get that kick to take action. Because that's what Martin Luther King or Gandhiji, or if you look at any leaders, right? Okay. They push the why so strongly, which motivated people to take action.
So somewhere, tell me, if we communicate the why very strong, are we also putting ourselves in a potential risk of diluting the importance of how and what? Because you would also want the execution also to happen effectively, isn't it? For example, tomorrow, if I work with you and I create a great leadership intervention for your organization and we talk about the why of it, etc. But if I don't execute it well to your level of satisfaction and requirement of your leaders, you would say this doesn't work for me, right? So isn't the how and what also equally important?
It is. It is, but you know, the thing is, you should not start with what or how, right? If you just focus on what or how, you know, that's what's happening in, like, if you look at a training program, right? So what do we teach? We teach them the what and how, like any technical training or any training, right? We teach them, you know, Python, whatever it is. So that is the what or how of the thing, right? But if the guy doesn't know, why am I learning this? Okay. Where am I going to use it? Okay. What is the bigger picture? Then it's of no use. I mean, you know, but if you ask me, can I do something without the what and how? Again, not possible. And especially from an organizational context. Somewhere in the book, he says, you know, there are leaders who are like, who have a very strong why, but very weak in how. You know, that can be disastrous as well. So the best combination is a leader with a strong why and having partners who are like, who have strong how and why.
That's
a deadly combination. That's when you see real result. Even in the case of Apple, it's the same thing. Like, you know, if you read biography of Steve Jobs, he was a strong why guy. But
was all the how and what.
He never bothered about the how. You know, for him, like, but thankfully, he has a strong team who was very good with that how and the what part. And so they push things and they got results. Yeah, so both are important. But, you know, why without how, you know, takes time, you know, because you can be really passionate, like, but I strongly believe, again, and this is very, you know, my personal belief, if you have a strong why, right, you know, your how will come to you.
You're right.
Come to you, which is in the sense, like, you will get the resources from somewhere to help you achieve your goal. So that's what I have experienced in my life. But not having a why, only having how and what.
Yeah. It's almost like walking in the desert, right? Without any strong purpose of where you want to reach, isn't it?
Yeah, true.
And I was just thinking.
You get tired. I mean, when you have a strong why, it gives you a lot of energy, right?
Purpose
and passion, you know, it is like, on the same this thing. So,
absolutely.
It gives a lot of energy. So, people why are very energetic.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, you know, when you said energy, I'm just thinking of an incident that happened a couple of months back, and I'm open to share this on open. Sure. One of a very good friend of mine, with very good intent, you know, during COVID times, businesses got hit. So I also had my bit of, you know, business getting hit. So he was having a chat with me and he was telling me, Rajiv, how are things? And things are fine, but definitely it's got hit. It just got deferred. Nothing is denied in business. It just gets deferred. I'm sure it should be fine. He said, you know, it's so nice. Would you also want to consider getting back to the corporate role? I said, okay, that's a intention is very strong. I can see that, but yeah. I wouldn't want to think about that because the very why is so strong. Of why did I start the Leadership Elements as an organization? My own passion of reading became a business model. And I wanted to bring in the power of books to create leaders and help them find their own leadership in themselves through books. Right. That strong purpose is so, so hard hitting in me. I know as Kemsiari talks about the flow, I'm already in that flow. I'm already in the ikigai of the purpose. Yeah. I wouldn't even imagine or the thought would never even flash across, can I get back to a corporate L&D role, which is anyway available time and money account, right?
Yeah.
So I'm able to understand it. Energy is what probably keeps giving me, even these difficult times, unusual times, there's an energy of know the purpose. And today the chat with you is also a purpose of how could you and me as book maverick readers, help the budding leaders to figure out their own channel of journeys.
Yeah.
I think you beautifully said that. Very, very good.
Yeah.
I also remember an incident, you know, our kids, right? You wake them up on a school day, oh, there's 5 minutes, 2 minutes.
Yeah.
But on a Saturday, let's say we are going to a grandmother's who is leaving at 5:30, they are up at 4:30 and they're all settled back to their life. So the why is so strong, even in 7 years, 6 years, 5 years, isn't it?
It is. So that's why this compelling vision, compelling future, compelling reason is what motivates people.
Yeah.
So the best leaders are leaders who are good in communicating that to people. If you fail there, then you don't have, you know, energetic team.
Absolutely. I agree. Lovely. You know, another statement that Simon says in this book, which again made very much sense to me, you know, the powerful statement of winning hearts and minds. I always knew that feeling comes, then your thought happens, then it converts into an action. All of us kind of read this, knew this, we've spoken about this. But I never kind of put these together and made myself think the way he made me think, that leaders should always focus on winning hearts first and then move to the minds, or the minds will eventually happen. I never thought these two together till I read that sentence, right? What's your take on that?
So these words, heart and mind, again, you know, we normally associate heart with emotions, right?
Yeah.
And mind with thinking, logical, and brain.
Cognitive.
Right? So, yeah, cognitive thing. So, as we said, like emotions, right, you know, push people, trigger people to take action.
Yeah.
So, if you don't win the heart, then, you know, we just talk using data, you know, if you're conveying things through logic, right, people may not get it. So it's like this. So I like this definition. So I don't know what's the source of this definition. It says the best teacher is a teacher who communicates his or her message without words.
Lovely.
Yeah. So the best teachers are teachers who communicate their message without words. So, you know, if you look at our Gurukul system and all this stuff, right? They convey like a lot of amazing stuff.
Right.
And people, you know, retained it for a long time. If you look at our education system right now, you know, we don't remember 80%. I mean, at least I don't remember 80% of the stuff I learned in school. Right? And then we just, you know, mugged up and, you know, finished the exam and then we just like shift deleted. So, but that's not the case in those, you know, the Gurukul education system. So there, if you study the Gurukul education system, the way they teach, the way they communicate, it's between hearts. Okay. So basically, you stay with the guru, you be there, whether you're a son of a king or whoever it is, right? You have to be with him.
Yeah.
And there's an exchange of energy.
Right.
So, and this is a very powerful thing. So me as a facilitator, I've always experienced this. Like whenever if it's not about the feedback, it's not about what I said or whatever it is, whenever there's an exchange of energy between me and my audience, that training will be like really powerful and it'll be impactful. It's not about my, you know, the words or the PPT or what I share. So whenever I connect, and I've also experienced and observed this, only when I believe in what I say, only if I walk the talk, if I practice, you know, whatever I'm sharing, if I'm, you know, preaching, I'm practicing what I'm preaching, right? Only then people get that connect. There is an exchange of energy, exchange of vibrations. So, you know, this particular point is basically having that connect with the audience. And that connect through, you know, heart-to-heart connection. And that will happen only if you are inspired, if you believe in your mission. If you are a purpose-driven leader, all these things will happen. Otherwise, it will be just a mind-to-mind exchange.
Very transactional, isn't it?
Transactional, yeah, that's the right word. It will become very transactional. And that's what's happening in a lot of you know, places, a lot of meetings. A lot of politicians do the same thing.
You're right.
If you also listen to politicians, right? I'm not generalizing, but a lot of politicians, you know, they will have a lot of promises, you know, they will talk a lot of good stuff, but you and I know that it's not going to happen.
Correct.
You know, you look at each other. And this happens even at workplace. You know, say all during the team huddles and things like that, there are some leaders, real leaders, you know, will call for town hall and things like that, right? And then they'll give their, you know, planning, plans, whatever vision statements and things like that. And after the meeting, after the session, everybody will look at each other. I've heard it so many times, you know, because... you know, there is, you know, there's something is missing. You know, the audio and video is not matching. You know what I'm saying? So, so, but you know, there are some guys, they'll come and speak for like just 2 minutes, and that 2 minutes will be powerful, and you will remember.
It stays in your head for a long time.
Absolutely. You know, you'll, you know, Martin Luther King, right? You know, even after, you know, so many years, people remember his statement, and you know, that speech is because he was in complete sync with who he is and what he said.
Absolutely. What a strong why, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Very strong why.
Isn't it? Yeah, seriously. I mean, makes a lot of sense. And I'm just thinking as I'm listening to you, Srijit, you know, so many leaders are just running in my head as you're talking, who kind of touched my heart and they stayed with me. Yeah. And today, some of them, I elevate them as gurus and I thank them on the Teacher's Day saying, you know what, I've had so many people have shaped me what I am today, but there are a few of them who I can definitely call them as gurus, and I always prostrate in front of them and say, thank you for making me what I am.
Yeah.
They never created a Gurukul atmosphere for me, but they did what a guru did before the Shishya during Gurukul days, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you go back to our school days also today, I remember my history teacher very well, and I love history as a subject. There was tremendous energy.
Yeah.
There was some connect.
Yeah.
We are talking about experiential learning today, right? So many years back, I remember she one day taught us the war of Panipat.
Okay.
And she came to the class, broke us into two halves, and came with thermocoles and asked us to paint those into soldier, cut them into soldier pieces and paint them. I vividly remember the classroom had two halves. One had red soldiers, one had green soldiers. We were part of the green, and we had the Panipat live happening there.
Wow.
You know, it's vivid. I'm talking about what, 9th standard, 8th standard?
Yeah, see how powerful it is. You know, you still remember the whole thing.
You know, I'm able to see the classroom. Where did I enter? Yeah. Where did we place it? Where did the boys stand? Where did the girls stand? Who played the role of... It was magnificent.
But again, because, you know, that teacher touched you emotionally.
Yeah.
You know, we retain information when it is, you know, driven by emotion, right? If you look at the... If I asked you what happened... you know, on like last year, September 11th, you may not remember.
Yeah,
I ask you what happened on that day, that World War.
You're right. I think I lost you, Srijit. Srijit, are you there? You kind of froze. Looks like a challenge of signal at Srijit's side. Let's wait for him to come back. I think meanwhile, it was a very interesting conversation. How why become so powerful for all of us? I think for budding leaders also, what Srijit is saying or what Simon Sinek is saying makes a lot of sense. As all of you grow in your own leadership journey in your early 30s, coming to the mid 30s, figure out what is that why in your life becomes absolutely important. Yeah. I think we're having Srijit back. Srijit, are you there? I can see your name. Can you hear me? I think he's just coming in. Yeah, so I was saying, you know, for all of you, it's so important. Figure out, you would have started your career, you would have moved a couple of years ahead. Instead of just moving on by doing the how and what very strongly, get the why so clear in your head. When you do that, you will automatically fall in a place that you want to be in. And once you find out that spot, you will experience tremendous energy. And that's what Srijit is talking about. Hi, Srijit, you're back. Good to see you.
Sorry, I think
there's a signal issues. Don't worry. I was just summarizing to the audience the learnings that you gave. You know, the element of energy that can come in because of a very strong why, right?
Very, very nice.
So tell me, Srijit, how have you used and displayed the why to your teams across your leadership journey, because of which they have always respected you so much? Could you give an instance?
Okay. So as I shared something back, right? Trainings, right? So if you look at traditional trainings, there are active learners, there are, you know, like disengaged learners, right? There are some people who just come for training because their managers nominated them. You know, there are different kinds of learners. But I've experienced, right, whenever we communicate why to the public, whether you are an disengaged employee or, you know, if you're not sure why you are in the classroom, and if you can give the bigger picture, they always, like, you know, participate, you know, are active in the classroom. Right. So I'll give, there's a story, I mean, you must have heard it for sure. So there were three people doing three different things, right? So ask the first person, so what are you doing? So he said, like, I'm just doing my everyday job. Like, you know, I come here every day 9 to 5 and I finish this many tasks. Then the next guy, so I asked the next guy, so what are you doing? So his response is like, every day I take, you know, a couple of bricks, like some 100 bricks from this side, I'll put the other side. And this is what I do from morning to evening. So I carry bricks from one end to the other end. So I asked the third person, so what are you doing? So his response was like, you know, 2 years from now, a temple is going to come in this place and I'm part of the project. Right? So out of these three, you know, the third person, you know, will be really passionate, will be energetic, you know, he will do his best. Same with a lot of things in our everyday job, right? If you don't communicate that bigger picture, you will not see energy, you will not see motivation, you will not get results. So as a leader, you know, as a facilitator, so I make it a point whenever there's a new project or any initiative. So I start with the reason, you know, the bigger picture. So why are we doing, and how are we going to contribute to the organization? Wherever you can connect the dot. And when that's clear, right? You know, generally people, you know, will be engaged and, you know, will do their best.
Yeah. Makes sense, absolutely. So which means it brings us to the fact that start with why is the most beautiful title of the book, and that's the purpose in which all leaders should eat, breathe, and behave, isn't it? Thank you so much, Srijit, for those fantastic inputs. I think it was lovely having a chat with you. I'll leave you with last but one question. And then the last question is, what is your final advice to budding leaders who are in their early 30s, mid 30s, and moving up their career? What would be one or two advices?
Okay. The first thing is have, you know, clear goals. Okay, big goals. Because I see a lot of youngsters who are not very clear about what they want to do in life. They're not very clear. They don't have a clear path, clear journey path. You know, they just listen to their parents or even, you know, to their managers when they start their career. But if you have a clear destination, a clear goal, right, that gives you a lot of energy and motivation to do things. And the second thing is, you know, there are a lot of resources available, right? Whether it's strategies, tools, techniques, you know, there is no dearth of resources right now.
Yeah, yeah.
So you have to tap and kind of, you know, take the right stuff from the right place. And more than that, you know, practice it and implement it. You know, execution is the most important thing is missing right now, right? There are a lot of people I know, like, you know, read a lot of books, attend a lot of seminars, workshops. But at the end of the day, you know, there is no impact. There is no result. So we are measured by our result. So we have to, you know, keep remembering this, right? So if you're not making an impact, it's as good as not knowing that stuff.
Right.
So even if it is one or two things, if you take action and if you get result, then you're better than a lot of other people. So the power is in result. So they have to focus on results and they should know why that particular result and how they are changing lives or how they're contributing to the organization, whatever it is, right? So that should be very, very clear. Right. So when once these two, three things are, they're like, you know, having a clear goal, right? Knowing where to tap the resources and then working towards result, right? Makes a lot of difference.
Right.
These things are actually missing a lot of people. And like, it's very transactional these days.
Yeah, there seems to be a rush. There seems to be a rush and a hurry in people. I think what you said makes a lot of sense. If all the listeners here, when it goes live, can ponder on what Srijit is saying, that it's end of the day, it's about results. It's about finding those learnings from across and picking up that one that can take you closer to the results. And very, very clear purpose of your life and why of your life. I think three key learnings that Srijit gives us. Thank you so much, Srijit, for that. I'll close it with the last question. Your inputs on the concept of leaders and libraries that you have been invited for by the Leadership Elements. And as an organization, we work with organizations in building leadership capabilities through books. What's your thought on that?
It's a very powerful, you know, concept or idea, whatever you want to call. Because I believe, right, you don't have to reinvent the wheel, right? You can pick up what works. So books are all about what works, right? So you don't have to, you know, invest or research, do your own research and, you know, find out what works, what doesn't work. So the power is in picking up, you know, the right strategy, the right techniques, the right tools from the best books available, right? And then giving it in the best format. So your power is in the second category. See, like anybody can, you know, pull a book and read, right? But giving it in a format which is easy to understand, which is easy to practice, makes all the difference. Yeah. With the kind of things you're doing right now, where you are actually giving them the tools, right? It's like, you know, you searching for something and then finding and practicing. Like, there's nothing wrong with that, but it takes a lot of time. Yeah. But imagine, like, somebody's giving to you in hand, everybody, you know, this is
quick recipe.
Okay, I can give another metaphor. It's like cooking and eating, right? So you can, you know, do your own cooking and, you know, and eat, right? That's one way of doing it. Other one is like some expert chef or some real cook, you know, will cook it for you and give it to you. So what is the end objective? The end objective is like you have to enjoy the food.
Satisfy the hunger.
It should nourish you. That's the end objective, right? So to achieve the end objective, there are different mediums. So now what you're doing is the role of a chef, where you are actually cooking delicious meals and giving to people, you know, to satisfy their hunger for learning or hunger for improvement or hunger for progress or hunger for change, right? That hunger you're satisfying in the best, you know, possible format. So I'm really proud of what you're doing. So keep doing. And I've not come across many groups, or I know, like, there are a couple of books like Situation Leadership or The Seven Habits, and, you know, there are a couple of like international books. They have their own, you know, getting things done.
Yeah.
So they have their own, you know, training methodology and things like that. But those are like, you know, hardly like, you know, less than 100. But there are like thousands of books, right? Which has like powerful messages, powerful resources, right? So, I mean, what you're doing is like amazing. If you can actually take this to, you know, whatever, the mass, you'll see a big difference.
Absolutely. You're right, Srijit. Thank you so much, in fact, for two things. One, there are thousands of books available, right? And each book can be converted into a two-day, three-day workshops kind of things. Imagine the kind of learnings, you know, one can keep learning for 365 days of the year if each of these books can be brought into classrooms. And that's the very purpose that I'm living for. And how do I help leaders to find their own leader themselves through books, right?
Yeah.
And I love this metaphor of comparing me to a chef. I never thought that way, but when I'm thinking, again, a wisdom shot from you, Srijit, actually, probably I'm doing that, you know, trying to put a couple of things together and kind of helping the recipient to eat the right meal that could probably take him or her to one more step forward to become a better leader and become a far productive leader. Yeah. So thank you so much, Srijit, for coming on. It was a pleasure chatting with you. I look forward to see you in person. We are the same city. Would love to meet up sometime.
Sure.
Have a good time. Have a lovely health. Yeah. Take care.
Thank you so much. Yeah. So keep adding value to people. I'm, you know, so happy and you know, really like impressed when you shared about this particular concept, and I'm glad that I'm able to, and happy to contribute to your, you know, initiative. All the
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much. You have a lovely day ahead.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.